Everybody, this is Brother Chris Carr, and got a special guest here today. This is my dear friend, Brother Joseph Duke. Amen. And we're looking forward to this conversation here today, and I just pray and hope that something is said to encourage your hearts. So I'm going to let Joseph come on and tell us a little bit about himself.
Everybody, I'm Joseph Duke. I'm originally from Anniston, Alabama. Graduated from Sachs High School. Played baseball a lot with my brother here. We played with each other, against each other for many years.
Yeah.
I'm newly married, been married for just under 9 months. And then my wife and I moved down here to New Orleans. I'm attending seminary, pursuing a Master's of Divinity in Pastoral Ministry. So just good to be here, and hope that I can help in any way I can today.
All right. So we've been doing a little segment trying to get youth involved, especially when it comes to finding out what you want to do in life. I know a lot of people, they look towards sports, that being the given route to go. And then we have those special ones that are called into the ministry at an early age. And I know you've been called at an early age. So I wanted to bring you in and, you know, get some feedback and tell us a little bit about how you got called into the ministry, you know, what all happened in your progression thus far.
Of course, man. So I guess when I was a little bit younger, when I was ninth grade or so, I accepted the Lord when I was in seventh grade. And so a couple of years later, I just kind of felt like there was a little bit something more there. Mm-hmm. Just like there was a pull for something a little bit deeper. I really didn't know what that was. And for everybody, it's different. That's just kind of what it was for me. And so I started talking with some of my youth pastors, talking about a few different things, doing some different discipleship. And it just kind of stayed there for a little bit. So what really kind of tipped it over the edge is my sophomore year. When I was in the youth group, what we used to do every February was what was called a biblical love series, if you will. Mm-hmm. And so my youth pastor would kind of walk through what it looks like to have biblical love and, you know, how to have biblical relationships and all that kind of stuff. Well, at that time, I had just kind of broken up with a girlfriend that I just had for about 3 months or so. You know, I was devastated, all that kind of stuff. And my youth pastor, I remember specifically, he challenged us to take dating off the table for a period of time. Mm-hmm. And to use that time to focus on the Lord. And so I made a commitment that service. And I say this jokingly. I said, like an idiot, I said, I'm going to take dating off the table for the rest of high school. Mm-hmm. And I say that jokingly because it was definitely difficult. But during that time to where I took date, I didn't date for the rest of high school, two of the biggest things happened in my life. I accepted my call to preach, and I met my future wife.
Wow.
And so we didn't date until the day we both graduated. Mm-hmm. We hung out with each other, and we knew that that was eventually going to happen, but we didn't date until we graduated. And so that was a big part of that. That pull started kind of in ninth grade, but taking that time, taking some distraction off the table, mm-hmm. Really allowed for the Lord to kind of foster that and to grow that within me. And I accepted my calling in the ministry 10th, 11th grade, right in there somewhere, and then met my wife, Madeline, halfway through my junior year as well. So That's just kind of my story in a short little compact explanation, I guess. So.
That's all right. And I just listening to you talk a little bit, especially like that period that you took where it was no distractions, you know, and you were focused, you know. A lot of people I know, they say, you know, I've been called into the ministry, but they don't take advantage of that time, that much needed time to really bring and draw a relationship with God. Right. And I know as a minister myself, that relationship with God is very important, because if you don't have that, you're not able to give the people exactly what they need when it comes to you're about to preach a sermon, or you might walk up to somebody just you didn't even know, and God might lay a thought on your heart. And if you don't have that relationship, you're not going to be able to do those things, of course, in the time that we live in. But that's awesome, man. I commend you on that, because I know a lot of people, young people, especially now, they're really ashamed, you know, and they say they accept the call to salvation, and, you know, that they want to move forward and do things in ministry, but they don't take that initiative, you know, to really set themselves apart, you know, sanctification. And right. People don't really take heed to when it says, you know, the Bible tells us to sanctify ourselves and to really set ourselves apart, to be that difference and be that change in the world. And, but what would you say to a young person that's out there that's probably, you know, struggling, you know, really making that separation or trying to really get into a place where they're really drawing that close relationship with God?
Of course. And so what I would first say is, let me introduce it this way. Mm-hmm. And so when I was in the youth, and I'm just 23, so just, you know, I'm not far from any of the youth out there. I'm not too far removed. Just graduated about 5 years ago, so that's not too bad. But when I was in the youth, we always had a senior service. Mm-hmm. When it was getting ready for graduation. And right. It seemed that when I was in youth, and nothing bad at all toward anyone that went before me or anything, and not everybody was like this, but most of every senior that spoke said, I wish I would have done something a little bit differently. Mm-hmm. Well, continuing to hear that, it fostered in me that I don't want to be that. I don't want to have to, when that day comes, I don't want to stand up there and say, I wish I would have done this differently. I want to be able to say, do what I did. And so it really kind of instilled in me a drive and a desire to serve the Lord in that way. And so I introduced that not to boast about myself in any regard, but to say that you can do it. Is that if I can do it, so can you. It is possible. Now, is it difficult? Yes, it's very difficult. There were some people, there were some I'll just kind of use this as another example. There were some other people that were interested in me, and there were some other people that I was interested before I met my wife. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that was something that could have been great, but I had a commitment that I wasn't going to date. And, you know, that kind of brought on a little bit of hurt every once in a while. That brought mm-hmm. on some people that didn't really understand or that looked at me a little bit weird or different. And, but that's okay, because ultimately, we're called to live a little bit of a different life.
That's right.
And, you know, my commitment may not be exactly what the Lord has laid out for you. That's just what it was for my life. That's how He continued to set me apart and prepare my heart for ministry and for my wife. But I guess the advice I said is just be willing to allow the Lord to work in the way that He sees fit. Mm-hmm. And if you're humble in that and your heart is open in that, and your answer, this is something that's always big for me, is that I always used to tell my students, is let your answer be yes before the Lord even asked the question. Right. If your answer is yes, and you're faithful in that, then He is faithful to bring about maybe not always what you want, but what you need. Mm-hmm. And then once you rest in that, you'll see that it is what you want. If your desires line up with the Lord, then what He brings about is what you want, because you desire what He wants. And so it doesn't make it easy, but it makes it so worth it. And so I offer that is, if I can do it, trust me. And there were still many times that I made mistakes, many times that I messed up. But I worked and I served the Lord until when it was my time on that senior service, I could stand up and say, kind of as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11, follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. Is right. Follow my example. It's, you can do it. It's worth it. It's not easy, but it's worth it.
That's right. Yeah, that's awesome. And, you know, we were talking about how you went, basically in that description, when you were telling your students, you know, to always say yes, maybe think about Isaiah when he was in the temple and he saw the Lord. And his train filled the temple, and it, you know, it talks about how he, first thing was he repented. He was like, look, I'm unclean, you know, I'm not even worthy to be in your presence. And then he went and he went to confess about the people he was hanging around with. Yeah. And then he goes the next step, and the Lord's like, who's going to go for us? You know, He was, send me. You know, he didn't even know what kind of task he was going to have to undergo, but he said, send me. And, you know, that made me think about that. But that, man, that's a great example. Especially for those young believers that are out there who are really wanting to take that initiative, but just don't know how, you know what I'm saying? So it's great to have examples, especially now. I know, you know, our age group, there's really not too many people out there that's really trying to live for the Lord. There's a lot of people that say they're Christians, but they don't live a life that's pleasing to God. And in a sense, we could say they're hypocrites, you know what I'm saying? And so it's great to hear someone that is actually doing something for the Lord, and you can see the fruit that you're bearing and the many lives that you've touched. Not many people know, but Joseph, he's been a youth pastor for a little while, and he's been serving for a long time. Man, I've looked up to him for the longest. He just didn't know it. I was in the background saying, man, go for it, brother. Yeah, but what would you say to someone who is interested in becoming a youth pastor? What kind of advice would you give them?
So I'll say it this way, to offer as much encouragement, but as much reality as possible. Mm-hmm. Okay. If you feel led to do it, do it. Mm-hmm. If not, don't.
Right.
And I say it that directly because the bottom line is this, is that in the season of life that you're in, if the Lord is leading you in that direction and you say yes, you're faithful to Him, He'll be faithful to you. Mm-hmm. But if that is not necessarily where the Lord is leading you and your desire is not to serve, your desire is something else other than service, trust me, you don't want to be in it because it's not easy. Ministry in any respect is not easy. And the bottom line is we're all called to ministry. It's just we're called to, if you're called to serve in vocational ministry, you're just doing it in a little bit different way. And so if you're looking to serve, there's always ways to serve. If that's where the Lord is kind of leading you, and follow with everything that you have. But if you can't say, look, I really feel like this is something the Lord is leading me to do, I caution you to not do it. Because it'll bring there's heartache, there's long nights, there's tough situations that arise, and if you're called to do that, the Lord equips you in that. But if you enter in to where the Lord has not led, then there's not a promise that you will necessarily be equipped for that, and that's okay. There are other ways to serve, and there's no better way to serve than anywhere else. So what I'd say is, if that is something where the Lord leads, follow with all your heart. If it's not, find where it is leading you and follow all your heart. And, you know, that's the best advice that I can give, because I think the Lord, I trust in the Lord's faithfulness. And, you know, I'm never going to say, no, the Lord is not leading you one way or another. Only you can decide for that. Only you and the Lord truly know. And so if you can say, look, I know this is something the Lord has laid on my heart, then go for it. Because in that, the Lord is faithful, and I truly believe that.
Yeah, and, you know, just thinking about it, I know a lot of people, they're real anxious to get the mic, you know what I'm saying, and they want to tell people like it is, and they're like, look, you're going to do like I say, and yeah, I'm the man, you know, and that, you know, my dad would tell me, even before I began to start preaching, he said, look, preaching is only 3% of the job, you know. Yeah. It's not even that, you know, 97% is serving. And, you know, the chief was going to have to be the servant, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, let him, that's the minister, you know, you're going to have, basically what he's saying was you're going to have to serve no matter what. And I think about like in Acts, how, you know, when they sent out the evangelists, they started off as deacons, and they went to house, and they're looking upon the different ones, and a lot of people don't want to serve, man, but they want to come up on Sunday morning, live streams going, you know, it's hot. They want the one with the hand on the mic, and, you know, it's more than just that. And
when I first got here to seminary, this is my first, I just finished my first semester. Mm-hmm. We just have a new president of the seminary. He began last summer. And so he's kind of getting used to everything, and he's changing a few things, changing our mission statement, kind of wanting for us to find our identity and everything. And I remember on orientation, he said something that I completely understand and completely agree with, and kind of was just, but it was just very direct. It kind of caught me off guard that he said something like this in orientation, but he's exactly right. He said, look, If you're coming here for any other reason, you're coming to New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary for any other reason other than to learn to be a servant. Mm-hmm. He said, this is not the place for you. I don't want you to come. And for someone who, you know, for a seminary that relies on people coming and paying for tuition, and that's one way that we survive, I really looked up to that, because it's not about the tuition. It's about building and preparing servants for Christ. Mm-hmm. And he said, we want to be known as a seminary that serves. We want to be known as someone who takes the towel and the basin to every person in any situation. Mm-hmm. And especially somewhere down here like New Orleans, where it's very diverse, people from various backgrounds, various beliefs. Mm-hmm. We want to be a people that's known for being servants. Because as you said, people are hot to get the mic. Well, Jesus, he taught, he preached, but most of his ministry was through action. Most of his ministry was not through word. And, you know, a lot of the words that we see are when he is rebutting those that were hot on the mic with the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the religious leaders and the scribes. And those are some of his words where he's rebutting. But when he's just teaching, he does do that, and that is necessary. That's my favorite part. I love to preach. Mm-hmm. But his biggest part of his ministry was through action. And I think that's a good example that ours should be as well.
That's right. Yeah. So, you know, while you were talking about like seminary school, and so how did you get interested in seminary school? You know, what led you that route? I know many people that route's kind of far along, you know, along the way. Some people don't even think about going that route. I know as far as my father, he served basically as our youth pastor. And he never went that route, but that's a different avenue for other people. You know, it's not for everybody. So how did you get stumbled upon seminary school?
I'll put it this way: is I feel that my true calling is to pastor a church. Mm-hmm. So I served there in youth ministry. That was what was needed, mm-hmm. And that did, and that prepared me in ways that I can't even explain. But I've always felt that my true calling was to be a senior pastor. And so seminary was always in the distant for me. I attended JSU, got my undergrad there in public relations, always with the knowledge, knowing that I was wanting to go to seminary. Mm-hmm. And ultimately just get some good training. And what it means and how to not only, for instance, to rightly divide the word of truth and to be able to preach and teach it correctly, mm-hmm. but, you know, how do you run a church? How do you grow a church? How do you budget correctly? How are you good stewards with the congregation's tithes, and how do you honor the Lord through that? And all of those different things, as you said, that is the preaching is the 3% of it. Now, that may be some of the most important part, because that's when we're, you know, giving out and disseminating God's word. But the other 97% is important as well. And if you only do the 3 without neglecting the 97 other percent, then you're not going to do well. Mm-hmm. And seminary kind of takes all of that. And at least where I'm at, where I'm down here in New Orleans, our curriculum takes all of that and helps prepare you in each of those aspects. And so it's always something that I've wanted in the future. And so when Madeline and I, when we both graduated, we got married, that was the plan. So that's why we're down here now. So.
That's awesome. That's awesome, man. And then just listening to that, you know, that sounds like it's going to make you even more well-rounded than you already are, and help really piece different pieces together. I know a lot of people don't realize, but a church is a business, you know. And if it's functioning right, you will grow, you know, grow profits, you know, not only in terms of your congregation growing, getting membership, but also, you know, the financial aspect is very important, because without money, you know, you ain't going nowhere. I know one thing my grandfather always says to people who think they want a pastor, he always tells them, you better have a whole lot of money in your pocket, because you're going to be in trouble, you know. you're going to be in trouble one day, because a lot of times it's hard to get people to invest and get, you know, to buy into a product. But if you sell it good enough, you'll get as much buy-in as you can imagine. But
it's cool that you say that. My pastor put it this way, is because there's definitely a spiritual side to church and ministry, and there's definitely a business side.
Right.
And he said, you can't spiritualize the business side of church, but you also can't business the spiritual things of church,
right,
and or of ministry, if you will. And so, I completely agree. You have to do both, and they both kind of go hand in hand. Ultimately, although being under the headship of Jesus Christ, is that if the spiritual side of church is under his direction, it's going to thrive. But also, if the business side of church is under his direction, and sometimes that means doing things that don't always make 100% sense, then it's still going to thrive as long as it's under his headship. And so there's, like I said, our curriculum down here kind of helps prepare for a lot of that. So something I'm excited to dive into.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to seeing what happens next for you, man. That's awesome. I don't really know too many, especially people my age, that are saying they want to be a pastor. You know, you hear about people that say they want to evangelize and be a missionary, but you know, when it comes to pastor, you're taking on a whole nother beast. You know what I'm saying? So I wanted to move into another direction here, because I'm finding that this question right here is, it weighs on a lot of youth ministry leaders in terms of growing their youth ministry, getting young people to come. I find even here at our church, it's a challenge to get other young people to come, or get other young people to invite other young people to your church. So what would you say to those youth leaders that are battling this challenge?
Yeah, so I'm not going to act like I'm an expert by any means, but I will share some things that have helped along the way. If with as much time as you can, I understand if you're you may be doing it just on a volunteer basis or bivocational or any of that, I mean, sometimes you may not be able to. But when you are afforded, have a way and understand where your students go to school and hit those schools. Mm-hmm. Our schools are in the high schools, the middle schools, wherever, whichever age group you're serving with, that is the biggest mission field that your students are going to, they come in contact with. Mm-hmm. That is their mission field for 4 years of their life, is their high school. And when they see that you care enough to be in their school, a lot of times it instills something in them as well. So that's maybe something to show in something outside, but I think it all stems back from this. This is some of the best advice that I've been given, that helps with any type of ministry, but especially with youth ministry. Students don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. Hmm. And that's something that my pastor hit me with at one point, because like I said, I love to preach. That is probably my favorite thing. And so at some points in my ministry, I may have been on that little 3% where, look, and I've got this, and I'm studying, and I'm doing all this, and there's a place for that. It's necessary. And like I said, in order to rightly divide the word of truth, you've got to do that. But if students only see how much you know in the word, and they don't know how much you care about them, even if you do, what impact have you really made? Hmm. Some of the biggest impact that I had a couple of youth pastors, that they made in my life, is I knew that at any time I could text, call, visit, I could go to them, and they were there in that moment with me. And so that was some of the best advice. And like I said, that kind of extends out to any ministry. For adults, if they know that you care, if you're a senior pastor, they know that you care about them, care about their spiritual lives, care about their family, care about who they are and how they are growing in the Lord, then what you have to say means something. But if they only think that you're just up there because it's part of your job, then it goes one ear and out the other. One of my classes this semester, if you will, puts it as kind of this way. It is is rhetoric of preaching has ethos, logos, and pathos. I don't know, you may have heard that before. That logos is kind of the word there, or that ethos is kind of how the audience or how the congregation views the character of the one who is speaking. Well, if they look and view you as someone who cares about them, they know that intrinsically, then they know that what you say is ultimately for their benefit. If they don't know that, they don't know that you care, you've already lost a big part of the battle. And so make sure that your students know that you care. But like we kind of talked about in a couple of the last questions, how do you do that? You can't just do that by telling them you care. You got to show them. You got to be there when they don't know what to do. You've got to be in the trenches with them, because going to high school these days is tough.
That's right.
I mean, it was tough 5 years ago, and it's just getting harder.
Right.
And so you've got to show them that not only are you on their side, but and you're back, you're doing the same thing they're doing. You're battling. You're going to battle for the Lord. And when they see that you've got their back, and they're ready, and oftentimes, not all the time, but most of the time, there's every once in a while you'll have some students where you just pour everything into, and it just isn't fruitful. Mm-hmm. Sometimes that happens. It's discouraging, but I offer you encouragement. Your job, again, isn't to sanctify or to save or any of that. Your job is to be faithful. Mm-hmm. Your job is to lead and guide and direct, and how the Lord leads and guides and directs you. And so for the most part, for most students who see that you're pouring and you're desiring to pour into them, they are receptive to that, and then in turn want to go and do that for others. That's discipleship in its best form. Wow. I put it this way in a book called Growing Up by Robbie Gowdy. It's one of my favorite discipleship books. He talks about how the Great Commission, in order to fulfill the Great Commission, you have to have evangelism and discipleship. They are two oars to the same boat. And if you only have one oar in a boat, you're just going to be paddling in circles. And so you can't evangelize and then never spend time and disciple. And you can't only disciple those who had a relationship and never evangelize. You have to do both. And I think by caring and showing those students that you already have that you care, and then by being where they're at in the schools where you can, and then being a servant yourself, someone who evangelizes yourself, you show that as a model. And so those are some of the things that that I can offer as advice. Mm-hmm. You know, it all ultimately goes back to, what is your ministry based on? Is it based on program, or is it based on God's word? And, you know, if it's based on a program, it may last for a while, but if it's based on God's word, it may go a little slower, but it's going to be a lot stronger. So, just a couple of practical things there that all goes back to, they don't care how much you know until they know how much you care.
And that's powerful right there, brother. That gives you, especially me, a lot to think about, you know. It's challenging, you know, and that definitely puts things in a different perspective. You know, I know a lot of times it's easy to sit there and harp on different things, say, hey, you need to do this, you need to do that, and you're not there, then it doesn't amount for anything, you know. And I can definitely account, because I know there's young people out there that don't have both parents in their lives. Mm-hmm. But when somebody from their church would show up, that meant the world to them, you know. Right. And that made them want to come. And I remember times when my dad would be our coach, and we would have kids just always want to come, you know, come over, or, you know, because they knew my dad was going to be there if we had a game, you know what I'm saying? He wasn't going to miss a game. And if he missed it, something was wrong, you know, but they knew he would be there. And that definitely makes a world of difference in anybody's lives, just being there. And I definitely see the comparison, and how, you know, you should be able to tie that, you know, thinking about the scripture says first natural, then spiritual, you know. And if you're able to equate both of them together, and you get that mix going right, you get that blend, man, it flows. To any of the youth that are out there at the moment, you got any encouraging words that you might want to leave with them on today, especially in the times that we live in, this hour of uncertainty?
Is that correct? Okay, sounds good. I guess going back to a little bit of what I was talking about earlier with my personal testimony is it is possible to, even though it doesn't seem sometimes like it based on how our culture is, sometimes it seems impossible, it is possible to be faithful and serve the Lord in today's culture. Mm-hmm. And I think sometimes it just needs us to declare that, like, we can do this. Mm-hmm. And it's not impossible. Is it difficult? Yes, but it's always been difficult. It's always been difficult. People talk about, well, man, if I'd have just, you know, been there with Jesus, or if Jesus would just be here in this time with me, you know, it would be so much easier. It was still difficult back then. And he even tells us, he sent us something greater. For those of us who have a relationship with him, we have the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God living inside of us. And he even says that's something that through that you can do greater things than even Jesus did. He says that himself in his gospel. And so I say that to say it's not impossible. Mm-hmm. You can do this. You can do this. And so in that, trust the Lord. In that, be okay with having the Lord's acceptance over someone else's acceptance. I think that is something that we all long for. Something I used to talk to my students about a lot is, you know, every single one of us, it doesn't matter how old we are, we're always seeking acceptance in some form or fashion. Mm-hmm. We're always seeking acceptance. And whether that is from a parent that we don't get that from a lot, or whether that's from friends or a spouse, even possibly, or anything, a boss, we're all seeking acceptance in some form or fashion. Well, for those of you who already have a relationship with Jesus Christ, you've already received the greatest acceptance you could ever receive, and that is acceptance by God the Father through a relationship with Jesus Christ. So trust and rest in that and use that as encouragement when maybe you're not accepted by the culture of this world because you do stand out. Mm-hmm. Now, for those that maybe don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ yet, and I'll put it to you this way, is, you know, you can, whether it's harsh or not, it's the truth. Mm-hmm. You can either be accepted by the world now and die later, or you can die to yourself now and be accepted by God and live later with him forever. Mm-hmm. We all have a choice, and we all have that option. Who do you want to be accepted by? It's much more important to be accepted by God, who is always standing there with open arms, willing and waiting and wanting and desiring to accept you. It's much better for that than for anybody on this earth. And through that, and that encourages me. Now, I don't say that to say that it sounds so simple, and the bottom line is it's not, because we live in a world that probably has more distractions than any other time in history. I mean, think about all of the things that are pulling at students who are in high school these days, whether it be social media or homework or sports or a boyfriend or a girlfriend or any other this and TikTok and all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we give time to those things often at the neglect of our time with the Lord. Well, for someone in ministry, this may be some advice for them as well. I give you a little caution to a pitfall. It's very easy for that to happen to you as well. Sometimes it's ministry. It's very easy to give time to the things that you know you need to do. Spending time with students, being in the schools, working on different social gatherings to bring other students in and all this kind of stuff. And sometimes it's easy, or studying for a Sunday school lesson or studying for a sermon. And sometimes it's easy to do that and to neglect your own personal time. Mm-hmm. Think about here in seminary, man, it is way more difficult than I ever expected. When every single day I'm diving into something new, or I'm working one of this past semester, I took my first semester in Hebrew and learning to read and translate Hebrew and all that kind of stuff. And when you're spending every single day immersed in God's word, but more for a more technical sense, sometimes it's easy to allow that to become your personal time, but that's when everything becomes dry. Mm-hmm. Because it all comes back to the bottom line of this. When you spend time with the Lord, when you spend time with the Lord, you delight in the law of the Lord, as Psalm 1 describes the blessed man. Mm-hmm. There is nothing sweeter. The bottom line is, though, is a lot of times, even though we may know that, we do that, we've experienced that, the distractions of this world, it's so easy to still not put time there. But I urge you and I implore you through that, it's the best thing that you can ever do for yourself, is die to yourself, be accepted by the Lord, and spend time and rest in Him, in His Word, and in prayer with Him. It's not like you're going to do that 24/7, but that should be the guide of your life. And when you do that, all this other stuff that you're worried about, distractions, and being accepted by, that stuff starts to fade away. And it gets easier and easier.
Man, that's powerful right there, man. Got me ready to want to shout.
Yeah. And I'll say this one other thing is, if you're in a position and you know that you do have a relationship with Jesus, mm-hmm. but you're in a season that is kind of dry, know that that's also normal, and that might be for anyone. There's been many times, several times, like I said, this semester, even this semester where I'm down here in seminary, you would think it would be some of the most fruitful time of my life. Mm-hmm. But that's something that our new president, he really charged us and cautioned us to as well, is seminary can be some of the most dry time of your life because you spend every day in God's word, but it's not always for personal reasons. You're dissecting something for a sermon that you're having to write for a class, or I'm writing a hermeneutics paper about something, and it's about biblical things, but it's not spending time and allowing the Lord to work on my heart, spending time just resting in His word. And so there's been times even where I'm down here where it should be the most fruitful and thriving time of my life, where I've gone through seasons of dryness, even sometimes, honestly, a little bit right now, just being completely transparent, is, you know, finishing up the semester and pouring everything in, everything is 24/7 scripture, then sometimes it's a little bit easy to take a little bit of a step back. But we can't do that. Mm-hmm. We can't do that. And I say that to myself just as much as I say to anyone that this is advice for. But I offer it as encouragement. It's, if you have a relationship with Jesus Christ and you find yourself in a dry spell, the most beautiful thing is this: you don't have to stay there. Mm-hmm. You don't have to stay there. And in that, we find the acceptance of the Lord over and over again. And so, man, I cling to what we see in Hebrews chapter 4. As we see Jesus as our great high priest, it says that we don't have a high priest that is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect was tempted as we are, yet without sin. And then because of that, man, we can draw confidently to the throne of grace. Yeah. man, that's what I cling to in those dry spells, is the Lord Jesus Christ. He's not looking down from heaven going, man, I can't believe that you haven't spent as much time with me as you should. He's looking down from heaven going, man, God the Father, I understand. That was difficult.
Mm-hmm.
That was difficult. And he's there waiting with open arms ready to accept. So for students who may be going through a dry spell, for anyone who may be going through a dry spell, any of that, be comforted and encouraged that you don't have to stay there. That acceptance is still waiting.
Wow. That's awesome, man. So anybody listening, you can accept them right now. All you got to do is
right.
Yeah, that's awesome, man. I'm thoroughly encouraged through the word. You encourage my heart just listening to you, man. Definitely, you know, you just open up things that I need to work on, you know. And I know that someone else is going to be touched from this message. And, well, we ought to do it again sometime, man.
Anytime. Yeah. And that's what the beauty of this is as iron sharpens iron, one man sharpens another. You can't do it alone, and we're not made to do it alone. So, man, whether that be in ministry, whether that be in day-to-day life, don't go at it alone. It's not how we're created to be. But more than anything, don't go at it without the Lord.